everybody. Happy Mother's Day. Happy Mother's Day to all the mamas, grandmas, aunts. Even if you haven't birthed any children yet, happy Mother's Day to those who are, you have somebody looking up to you. That's a big deal. It's a big, big deal. There is something that I wanted to do before I even got started with anything else, but if you actually lost your mom, can I have you stand up, please? Because I know that we are all celebrating our mamas, but there are some people really hurting and can't go visit them today, can't have lunch, can't hear their voice. So I asked Sandra. Sandra's on our prayer team. She's the one at the end of services laying hands on you guys as we come every Sunday. And she prays for everybody. But in particular, I asked her to pray about this. So if you lost your mom, I would love for you to stand up. And we're just going to share a quick prayer over you because I know it's not easy. Go ahead, Sandra.
Lord, we just thank you today. As we come together, Lord, as we celebrate Mother's Day, I pray, Lord, that you just touch and comfort every heart that is standing before you, Lord, that as they have dealt with the loss of a mother, Lord, and though they're not here in the physical form, remind them, Lord, that in spirit and in their hearts, they will be with them always, Lord. Remind them that you are the God that heals every broken heart, Lord, that you will be with them, Lord. And I just ask, Lord, when emptiness, those feelings of emptiness may arise, that you just fill them up yes. with your presence, Lord, that you just deposit your strength within them, your joy, your comfort, Lord. And we thank you, Lord, for who you are and what you do, Lord. Your word is true, and we believe in all of it. In Jesus' name I pray, amen.
Amen. I think something we do really good together, we celebrate with each other, we go to each other's weddings, we attend our children's games together, we go to graduations together, but for those of you guys who are mourning today, we want you to know that we mourn with you too. So everything, this is a community of family, this is just a bigger family of what you've been birthed into, says you have a bigger family now, and we're here to do everything together, laugh, dance, and mourn. And be sorry. I have a couple videos I want to show you guys. No particular order, but they are some funny videos of moms.
Mom, I'm still getting rejected from all these internships, and I really think this summer I should just travel and spend the time finding myself, like defining my values, figuring out who I am, what I'm about.
Stop right now, because you're giving me a headache. What defining values, finding? I found you. I take you out of my body, and I said, okay, here, give her the values.
No, Mom.
I wrote the values on a piece of paper, and you already have them. You don't need to waste your time.
No, come I have to work. Figure them out for myself. No. And besides, we have different values.
No, what?
We do.
Have you lost your mind?
You and Dad are always stressed out. I want to just have fun.
Oh, my God. Oh, my God.
For a walk. And go for a hike.
I go for a walk all the time.
You go for what? You walk the same block. The same block.
So what is wrong? It is still walking. The body doesn't care how many blocks you're walking.
I want to discover new things. New walks.
There is nothing to be discovered. Everything has been discovered. Just go get a job. You know what? Discover a job.
Mom. Finally today, keep your eyes on the mom.
This mom is ready to rumble. She can hardly contain herself at her son's wrestling match. She grabs onto her husband, giving him a smackdown worse than anything on the mat. Another mom capturing it on her cell phone can't stop laughing. And here's the wrestling mom herself, Dana Harpst, at home in Athens, Pennsylvania, with her son, Cooper. Is this your normal behavior on the sidelines?
The way I act is just every match when my boys wrestled.
Was it distracting for you?
It kind of encouraged me to keep going because she was very enthusiastic.
You could say that again.
So funny. So if you're a mom in this place, please stand up. We have a gift to give you. Stand up. Stand to your feet. We want to thank you for being our cheerleaders. Mama with the, that's my girl shirt. Sports mom, if anybody of you have your kids in a dance or a sports, you know that last one really hits home. So thank you to all you guys. While they're passing these out, I'm just going to pray real quick. God, just thank you for all that you've done. Thank you for motherhood. We thank you for the moms we have. We thank you for even the moms that didn't actually birth us, but we have an opportunity and can say thank you that we can look up to them. And we just love you, God. We thank you for giving women an opportunity, Lord, to partner with you in life. It's such a tall task, a huge order. But you chose us because we were capable, and whatever you expect of us, God, you actually inject into us. So we thank you for that, for having confidence. Crown these women with confidence, Lord, this morning. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. One of my brothers is going to be really mad because I'm preaching, because he really wanted to hear Pastor Vaughn. But it's me today. He's probably like, oh, great, here we go. I get to hear her again, preaching again. His whole life, I've been preaching. No, just kidding. So we do so much as moms. We support, we cheerlead, we teach, we cook, we drive, we dance with, we read to, we play with, we talk to, we listen, we comfort, and we scold. But there is something still missing that we need to intentionally do with and for our kids and family. If you're a father in this place, or even a teenager or a child, you're going to think that you can check out, but not necessarily, because you are going to have to do the same thing. And wait till you hear it. We have to teach and keep doing this for our kids, with our families, with great intent, with desperation, with boldness, with courage, and no hesitation. You guys ready? Teach repentance. Yeah. Repentance. Sincere regret or remorse is Google's definition. But God's definition is way more than that. He expresses and expects another level. He always goes above and beyond what we think or what we can imagine. He always does that. He tells on the Sermon on the Mount, this whole group of people, he says, hey, if you actually have hate in your heart, or you have bitterness or something against your brother or sister, you're actually committing murder. He takes it to a whole nother level. He tells men and women, hey, if you are actually looking at the opposite sex with lust, you've already committed adultery. You don't even have to get into the act of it. It's the desire, the thoughts, it's already happened. God goes way beyond the Google definition, our definitions, and he takes it to another level. He doesn't just talk about the law. He doesn't make sure we meet it, but he is the missing piece to it. The Sermon on the Mount is all in Matthew. However, if you know Jesus, repentance doesn't stop at regretting, and neither should we. Jesus deserves an apology. We all deserve an apology from other. We need to be giving them and taking them and receiving them. But Jesus expects change, development, advancing, and growth. And growth. Yesterday, we actually hosted a family here. And it was a mom and her sister. So they were elderly moms. And both of them lost their eldest sons. So they were calling for a place to host a memorial service. So yesterday we had funeral for two men. One was 58 at the time of his passing. The other one was 61. And it was such a pleasure to honor and host this family, just give them a place to remember their loved ones, talk about it. Leading up to yesterday was brutal. It was crucial, it was stressful. It was like, but one thing I really, really enjoyed is getting on the phone with the moms. I loved to hear the stories about their sons, what they were involved in when they were toddlers, what happened at their teenage life, what they got into, what they didn't, what they chose to stay out of. It was just lovely. And honestly, it's part of my like personality. I love to get to know people. I can sit and listen all day long about your story. I love to know your story, what happened to you, why are you the way you are? What has shaped you? But I just love it. I love to watch docuseries. I just finished the Tupac one, Dear Mama. So good, so good. Me and Isaiah are so excited for Conor McGregor's docuseries to come out on Netflix, because we'll get to know a little bit about Conor McGregor, maybe even about his mom too. But I love to watch stuff like that. But this morning, I know it's Mother's Day, and we're gonna be able to celebrate our moms, grandmas, and aunts, and all that good stuff. However, just like yesterday, and it was just confirmation for me, I'd really like to direct our attention to two sons. Two sons. And how vulnerability and repentance is a lifestyle. If you're taking notes, vulnerability and repentance, it's a lifestyle. It is not just a moment to be saved. It is not just the moment for salvation. It's a lifestyle that we have to be teaching each other. We have to teach our kids and our kids' kids and other people's kids. If we can all turn to Luke chapter 15. Luke chapter 15. At verse 11, and we'll have the scriptures up, and then I'll show something. Then he said, if you have your Bibles, he is God, or Jesus, because he's actually, it's all in red, so it's his words, not mine. Take his word for it. A certain man had two sons, and the younger of them said to his father, Father, give me the portion of goods that falls to me. So he divided them to his livelihood. And not many days after, the younger son gathered all together, journeyed to a far country, and there wasted his possessions with prodigal living. But when he had spent all, there arose a severe famine in that land, and he began to be in want. And he went and joined himself to a citizen of that country, and sent him into his fields to feed swine. And he would gladly have filled his stomach with the pods that the swine ate, and no one gave him anything. Verse 17, but when he came to himself, he said, how many of my father's hired servants have bread enough and to spare, and I perish with hunger? I will arise and go to my father, and he will say to him, Father, I've sinned against heaven and before you, and I am no longer worthy to be called your son. Make me like one of your hired servants. Verse 20, and he arose and came to his father. But when he was still a great way off, his father saw him and had compassion and ran and fell on his neck and kissed him. And then the son said to him, Father, I have sinned against heaven and in your sight, and I'm no longer worthy to be called your son. But the father said to his servants, bring out the best robe and put it on him, and put a ring on his hand and sandals on his feet, and bring the fatted calf here and kill it, and let us eat and be merry. For this is my son, who was dead and is alive again. He was lost and is found. And they began to be merry. Stop there. I have a picture of a painting by, this is an oil painting by Rembrandt from the 1600s. And I just want to point out the younger son. I hope you guys can see it well. The younger son, he's kneeling, resting in his father's bosom. He's bald. He seems to be exhausted. He's without a coat, and he's wearing only one shoe, and he's disheveled or messy. He's a picture of a life broken. The younger son has demanded his share of the estate, and then he ran away from home. He shames his father, disagrees with his father, but things eventually go so badly that he's reduced to tending pigs. Now, back in those days, if you were tending to pigs, or you couldn't be next to a swine or at all whatsoever, it was just as bad and as unclean as being with a prostitute if you were hanging out with pigs. Finally, the son comes to his senses and decides to return home. And he approaches the house with shame. His father sees him from a long way off, but he's coming home and his father is sprinting towards him. He runs to his son. He embraces his son. He even before his son could even start with his speech. Imagine, even before you could even say sorry, your father's coming for you. The father's love is so extravagant and it's excessive. It's like so much more than he expected. The father's love is extravagant and excessive. Not only does he reinstate his son's position of authority by replacing his clothes, giving the best robe, outfitting him with shoes and clothes of a free man, this younger son's brokenness, this provides for us a picture of the Christian life. This really provides for us a picture of the Christian life. We will be broken. Everybody say when, not if. There's no such thing as if we will be broken. This world is a broken place. Adam and Eve have sinned. The fall has come. It's broken. It was hard yesterday, even at this funeral, to explain to this family. It was never meant for us to deal with death. Some of us are becoming numb to it because we see it on social media, we see the news, we see a ton of it, but we were never meant to deal with that. We're never meant to deal with brokenness, but it's here. It's here. A lot of times we only kneel in repentance at salvation. Instead, we have to endeavor in such a way that our posture towards God is of constant brokenness. Constant vulnerability, constant humility, constant, like every day, mamas, teach your kids every day to repent before they go to bed. They might not even wake up. That is not even in our control. And mamas, the kids won't be doing it if we don't do it. If any of you know me, I say this all the time, every time I'm up here, I hate wearing the seatbelt. Hate it. And every time we get into the car, yes, I've learned. Every time we get in the car, Nate's like, mom, seatbelt. I'm like, oh my God. And I said, I feel like so restrained, Nate. Like, I can't move, I can't, like, but it's for my safety. And every time now that I don't do it, I say, sorry. Dang it. Sorry, Nate. And then I put my seatbelt on. How many times do we say, just sorry, God? Sorry that I went off on that person. Sorry that I passed by those homeless people. Sorry that I'm so on schedule that I can't stop and be flexible. If you can relate to that. Sorry that I don't have time to read your word. Sorry that I don't have time to pray. How will our kids know to stop and pray if we don't? If mothers and fathers are not showing them? We have to lean into God and remember that we are so lavishly overwhelmed by his love. And it comes from repentance. It comes from repentance. It comes from saying sorry. On the other side of that coin of sorry is grace, is mercy. So like we're running towards God, he's running towards us. James 4:8 says, if you draw near to me, I'll draw near to you. He just wants this posture of leaning in, of inquiry, of repentance. He just wants that type of posture daily. He's like, everything you have is because of me. And it's so out of order. So out of order. We'll go days without thanking God. We'll go days without saying sorry. We must be intentional moms. We must teach this. The father sets the standards, if you are taking notes. The father set the standards, and the mom creates the space for them to be met. Fathers, set the standards in the home. We will read, we will pray, we will say sorry, we will give thanks, we will serve one another. Set those standards. Whatever your house's standards, whatever you want it to be, let it be. Father, say, I'm never going to say the word divorce. That word will not enter my house. Fathers, you have to set the standard of, no, daughter, you're not bringing no boy in here. And it's a mother's job, though, to create a space to meet it. Remember what your father said? Remember what your father wants? Because that's the same thing. That's what God does. He sets the standards. And us as Christians, we got to create a space for us to meet it, but for other people to meet it, to find it. We got to set that space up. We got to create that space. What do? We partner with God. God says, I am the Father. Church, you are my wife. You are my bride. I tell you what I want, and you make it happen. You can make it look pretty. You can make it big. You can make it small. You could have fog machines. You could have lights. Do whatever you want to do. But I set the standards. You guys create the space for it to be met. You guys partner with me. This younger son, and you guys can keep that painting up. This younger son, he wasn't shoved to his knees, but he chose to kneel. And we have to teach the children the same thing. Mothers, aunties, teach the kids, you have to choose to kneel. You have to choose your lifestyle. You have to choose what you want in life. You can't shove it down their throat. Let them choose. The younger son kneels because he was doing life selfish. And we are all guilty of selfish. I have never realized how selfish I am until the older I get. The more I get in age, I'm like, I want my feet rubbed. I need my specific blanket. I was telling Pastor Vaughn, if anything happens to me and I have to go to the hospital, you must bring this blanket. This one right here. I don't care if it's washed. I don't care what happens. But this blanket must be on my body. It's the only way that I relax. It's heavy. It's thick. And I need this blanket. I never realized how selfish I was. And now when he says, what do you want to go to eat? Green tomato grill. What do you want for your birthday? Sneakers and earrings. The older I get, the more selfish I realize. Like, dang, I'm pretty selfish. He always tells me, oh, you need to eat. Don't just feed the kids and us and serve us. I told him the other day, one thing you don't have to worry about is me starving. You never have to worry about me not eating or feeding everybody else before me, because I'll eat while I'm cooking. I won't go without a meal. I won't. Especially vegan, I can only eat so much. So when it's there, I'll eat it. But we become deaf to the voice that calls us beloved. There are dark voices in our world that really try to persuade us that we are no good. That we can only become good by earning goodness through this ladder of success. That's not true. We all flee the hands of blessing and run off to a faraway place in search of love. We are all guilty. We run from our father's house, our father's arms, who has everything. And we go to this far off place looking for love, searching for love. Now let's take a look at this older son. This is what it looks like to stray away from weakness and brokenness. You guys know who the older son is? He's the one standing right there on the side looking down. Not the one in the back, but the one kind of facing the father and son, just kind of watching. He appears to be judging, annoyed, disproving of his father's lavish reception of this younger son who's disgraced his family, who's squandered the family fortune. although the older son has done nothing wrong, his heart is still not right. He is actually more lost because he's not even aware that he's doing something wrong. He's not even aware that he's standing like this, so judgmental. Yesterday we had and hosted a family that I've never met before. I didn't know what was they were going to bring, do, say, I don't know. And I didn't even know if this funeral was real because I never met these people. It could have been like, hey, this is all fake and we're coming to get you. I don't know. I have no idea. Everybody's, you know, crazy. So they bring in a cooler and I'm like, oh God, Lord help us. God forgive us for we don't know what we're doing. I don't know what's in the cooler. I don't know if it's whiskey, Hennessy for the homie. I don't know if they're popping off, you know, the beer. I have no idea. I have no idea of their character. Oh my God, what if a friend is really mad at somebody else and they start fighting? What am I gonna do? I have no idea if the family is even on the same terms. Remember, we have two families, two mothers bearing two sons. I have no idea. So I can totally relate to this older son. I am like, what did you bring in here? Oh, Jesus, what are you saying? Please stop cussing. I could have totally been that way. But because I knew what I was talking about, because I've already studied this portion of scripture multiple times, I've already told myself, no. It's beautiful that they're actually in the house of God. Thank God they didn't smoke inside, they just went outside to smoke. And at least they're learning about the Father's love. At least they're hearing that Jesus is good, that death was never intended. We were never meant to be broken or deal with sorrow or grief. At least they're hearing hope. Where our healing comes from, where our help comes from. He's actually living in the Father's house, this older son, but he's far from his Father's love. And this should be a warning to us all that it is possible to obey God's commands and serve in his house and still be far away from your Father and still be separated because your heart's not right. Because we haven't repented. Oh, that's for the new believer. We haven't rededicated our lives. Oh no, that's for the sinners. We don't do that as the older sons and daughters. Here's how to really sense, like if you're falling into this older brother, older son territory. It's when we have anger that you can't even process. You're just mad. I'm just mad. We can't even process anymore why we're angry, who we're angry with. Everything's just bothering us. And then we direct it at somebody. Usually it's the people closest to you. So those who live with you, you kind of like shoot the arrow, let it go, but you don't even know why anymore. We find ourselves complaining and grumbling. That's older son territory. If you find yourself complaining and grumbling a lot about everything, that's older son territory. If we have a hard time letting go of hurts, listen, everybody say when.
When.
Not if. Not say it when.
When.
Not if.
Not if.
You are hurt. You gotta let it go. You gotta find forgiveness in your heart. You have to remember all the things that God has forgiven you for. Let that be in the forefront of your minds. When it's hard to let go of hurts, when it's hard to let go of somebody hurting you or what's been done to you. As the older I get in ministry and in Christianity, as I mature, more and more do I realize, who am I to think I won't be hurt? Who am I to think I won't get angry? Who am I to think that I won't be broken? Who am I? I will be broken. But how will I respond? I will get hurt, but how will I respond? My children will drive me crazy, and they will fall into sin, but how will I respond? How? A couple weeks ago, and I asked her if I could share, but I caught Naomi in a lie, and I was furious. First, I asked her the question. She was like, no, Mom, no, that's not the case. I didn't do that. And I was like, really? You didn't do that? And I was starting to believe her. And then she turned, and I saw something, and then I said, are you lying to me right now? And she was like, no, I'm not lying. I said, oh, you're lying. And the conversation ends here. At this moment, conversation is done. So she gets in the car. I'm quiet. And beware for the quiet ones, because they're usually like, it's thoughts and, you know, it's like forming and it's like a stew. Anyways, so we get home and I say, oh, you want to be a big girl? You want to do what your friends do? And you want to cover it up and lie about it? I said, be a big girl and own up to it. That's what grown women and men do. Don't lie. But if you want to do what they do, just do it. And be honest about it. Don't lie about it. Don't cover it up. Don't try to make me believe anything. But you want to be a big girl? You want to you want to be a really, really big girl, but you want to lower the consequences. No, it doesn't work like that. It doesn't work like that at all. Be grown if you want to be grown. And take it when it comes. Don't you ever lie again. If you want to do wrong and be proud of it. Yes. A couple months ago, even my son was wrong and he got caught with something. But the one thing he did, that was the first time I ever saw it, and I was proud, but I was mad. And he was like, yeah, Dad, I did it. Here's why. And we said, no, don't explain, don't justify. You did it, and that's it. And now there's a process of repentance we have to show you. Things get taken away, blessings get taken away, but there's a process of repentance. You know why? It's better to deal with the consequences than to allow this sin to keep going and going and going. And then you guys can leave that oil picture up, the painting. Because and then you'll turn out like that older son. You'll keep covering it up and you'll just be annoyed by somebody who's exposed. You'll keep hiding what you're doing and how your heart is, and you'll judge somebody who's kneeling as you stand tall and proud with a fake heart. When will we become honest? When will Christians become honest? Mothers and fathers, when will we become honest? We got to teach our kids honesty. Honesty, it leads to humility. And that's the only way into heaven. If you're taking notes, it's not perfect people who go to heaven. It's not rich people who get in there. It's forgiven ones. That's it. It's not pretty. It's not good looking. It's not wealthy. It's not the gifted athlete. It's humble ones. It's forgiven people who enter the kingdom of heaven. Write that down. You got to be honest. Honesty leads to humility. Humility takes you to heaven. When we exercise power and control by not greeting somebody who has slighted us, that's an older son territory. When we exercise power and control by not greeting. If RJ did something wrong to me and I exercise my power and control and say, I'm not saying hi to him today. That's older son territory. If you can't even greet somebody in the house of your father who's welcomed you and I in with one shoe, tore up clothes, used and abused, scratches, scars, drugged up. We've all been there. We've all been there. He took us in like that. We got to be intentional about remaining fully aware of how fragile we are. We're fragile people. Fragile. And when you realize how fragile you are, then you realize the extent of how wide, how high, how deep Christ's love is for us. Ephesians 3:18. If we can turn to there, Ephesians 3:18. This is Paul writing to the church in Ephesus. Starting at verse 18. So that we may be able to comprehend with all the saints what is the width and length and depth and height. To know the love of Christ which passes knowledge, that you may be filled with all the fullness of God. The only way is to realize how fragile you are so that his love can meet that emptiness in us, so that his love can restore the brokenness in us, so that his love can forgive our sins. It's so important. This world and church, we're full of both the younger son and the older son. And we'll be different ones at different times. But it's really, really important, really, really important to recognize when you are in the older son's territory. And kneel. Choose to kneel. Choose to kneel. Don't be shoved to kneel, but choose it. Choose repentance. There are so many younger sons running away. We have children that are on the streets. And there are mothers in here praying that when they return to the Father's house, that there are older sons kneeling too and helping and washing with a word and cleaning. I know a mother right here, right now, begging for that. That when her child returns to the Father's house, that all of us are not like this. Yeah. Oh, how long is this going to last? You know what I mean? Yeah. And it might be your child, and it might be my child. We have no idea. I taught the youth group on Friday, and I said, it's not if you fail, it's when you fail. Let me teach you how to fail. Repent, say sorry, and change. God wants us to change. Jesus takes it to a whole nother level, and he even tells, there's a woman caught in adultery, and scribes and Pharisees, people of the church, take her to the temple. Take her to church. And they say, Jesus, this woman was caught in adultery. What do you think? You know, they're trying to see how he responds. And he says, you without sin, if any of you are without sin, go ahead, throw the first stone. You're justified. Go ahead, do it. And one by one, from the eldest, scripture says, from the eldest in the church, one by one, they start walking away. And they're like, dang, he's right. Dang, I have sinned. I didn't keep the law. I couldn't keep the law. I didn't keep it last week, that morning. And so Jesus is actually writing in the sand. He looks up. Everybody's gone, and then it's just him and this woman who has committed adultery. It's just them two. And he's like, where is everybody? Where's all your accusers? Is nobody here to condemn you anymore? And he says, neither do I. He says, go. But sin no more. Repent. Enjoy life and sin no more. This is another thing, mamas, that we need to keep teaching our children. After you repent, don't do it again. Sin separates you from the Father. Sin separates you from the Father. And you don't want to be separated. You don't want to be separated. When the time comes and he's looking, scripture says he looks all throughout the earth. His eyes go back and forth, looking for those who are his. And if he looks at you and he finds you, where will he find you? What will you be doing? I promise you, you're going to pray, Lord, find me on my knees. Find me in your house. Find me in your presence. Find me in your word. Find me praying. That's where you want him to find you, when he's looking for you. It's so crucial that we ground our walks and journeys in life by practicing this vulnerability and repentance every single day. Let's stand to our feet. God's culture is opposite. His pathway to power and strength is opposite of this world's. We place a high value on power and influence. We're so dazzled by celebrities, famous artists, those with thousands of followers. And we attribute like this great power to the wealthy and successful, those who are brilliant intellectually, those athletes that are really gifted. That's where we have our focus. God's different. God's opposite. God's opposite. It's like, in the moment will you choose me? In the moment will you have integrity? When nobody's watching, will you turn that porn off? When nobody's watching, when you come across somebody who's hurt you, will you be forgiving and open? Or is in your heart, you're angry, you're frustrated? And we can all be seduced by this world's definition of power. Nobody is too far from that. Nobody is too good for that. You will be influenced. You will be seduced by what the world is telling you is the definition of power, success, wealth, prosperity. You know what God says? He says, when you are humble, I will exalt you. That's his definition of success. And he says to the proud, when you guys are proud and you're in that older son territory, oh, I will humble you. I will. We can work with all our might to avoid vulnerability, brokenness. But we have to remember God's definition is more than that. It's the opposite of what this culture and this world is teaching us. It's the opposite of what your children are swamped in. They're drowning in somebody else's definition of success. Francis Chan puts it like this: we have age-old, ancient truths. And then your friend tomorrow or yesterday, your friend who you just met freshman year, will tell you something, and you'll say, yeah, screw God. You'll forget this truth. Bibles and scriptures that has been passed down from generation to generation, and you'll believe your friend from math class. We'll refuse this that has been proven, that has been found and proven. And we'll believe what a famous TikToker says, and we'll try that. We don't need Christianity anymore. It's okay if you're spiritual. Not necessarily. God will tell us. He will ask us all. And I think this is something we fail to even show and remind our kids to teach in this journey of life, this process, this day-to-day. Let me tell you what this day-to-day you must build on. I try to teach all my kids. Every single day you must prepare for the moment you face Jesus. Every single day. So that means if you're playing basketball and you're an athlete, you better prepare to discipline your body, because if you discipline your body to play a sport, then you'll be disciplining your body when some girl tries to come up and hook up with you. It's just discipline. Let's teach our kids discipline, the principles that will work in every area, but the most important is Christianity. Let's teach everybody to be healthy, Be honest. All throughout life and every other area, so that when it comes to Christianity, you're prepared for that one moment. When that one moment comes, I guarantee you, you can mark my words, you're gonna wish you gave more money, you're gonna wish you gave more time, you're gonna wish you read more, you're gonna wish you prayed more, you're gonna wish you knew what he looked like. You're gonna wish, and mamas, tell your kids all about this, because nothing else matters. I saw it yesterday. Nothing else matters as much as that. Are we preparing the next generation for that one moment? For that one moment when you're face to face with Christ, when you're face to face with God. Every single day is a life, is a time to build. What are you doing for that moment? What are you doing for that moment? Bow your heads with me. How fragile you are and how much you need God, you have an opportunity this morning, and it is not about a show. It is not a performance. This is between you and God. If you don't know, if you are not confident, if you are not for sure know where you're going when you're face to face, if you don't know, now's the time to say, I want to go there. I want to go to heaven. I want to make sure I'm okay. I want to make sure I'm prepared for that moment at my last breath. You have an opportunity today. And the Bible says that all of heaven rejoices in one sinner who repents. All these other older son territories. So if that's you this morning, you've never said, God, I want you. You must increase, so I must decrease. Just raise your hand wherever you are. I'm not gonna call you to the front. If you want God, if you want to say sorry, if you want to repent, could be for what you did yesterday, could be for what you've been doing for months. But if you've never actually truly repented and said, God, I'm sorry, you deserve an apology, so much more, but it starts with I'm sorry. Just raise your hand wherever you are. God sees you. Your Father and all of heaven is rejoicing. Your Father in heaven and all of heaven, all those surrounding him are rejoicing. You have all the angels shouting out your name, saying, write that one in the book, because when he comes, we'll have a record of his repentance. God doesn't care about our church attendance, but he takes record of our repentance. So today, if you want to join somebody else who just did it, just raise your hand where you are and repent. I'm not calling you up to the front. Oh, we see you. I see you. All of heaven sees you. May you be refreshed, renewed. May God crown you guys with confidence that you are forgiven. Anybody else? Before we move on to this other territory, know for sure where you're going, if you're going to heaven or if you're going to hell, if you're not for sure, just tell him right now, raise your hand and tell him, I want to meet you, God, and I want to be forgiven. I want to make sure that my slate is wiped clean. Just raise your hand wherever you are. Now for the older son territory. And this is gonna take some bravery, some boldness, some courage. I'm not gonna shove you to your knees. Your pastor's not gonna shove you to your knees. The person next to you shouldn't be shoving you. But choose to kneel. The altars are open. Choose to say sorry. Say, God, I'm sorry I've been annoyed. Sorry I've been frustrated. Sorry I've been judgmental. Get my heart right. I do what you say. I serve in your house. But my heart is far from right. I'm bitter at home. I'm angry. I'm always shouting. My patience is very low. The altars are open. You can just come and meet with your God, meet with your Father, and choose to kneel with that younger son. If you have given your life to the Lord this morning, come to the front and choose to kneel. Say, God, I'm sorry. I want a new start. I'm tired. I'm weary. I need your help. We think that it's always this gambling addiction. We think that it's always going to be pornography. We think that it's always going to be about vaping. That's not the case. God wants us kneeling when we have cancer. God wants us knowing how fragile we are when we
Love is so much sweeter Anything I've tasted, I want to know your love. I want to know your love. I want to know your love. I want to know your
There's no shadow you won't light. No shadow you won't light up. Mountain you won't climb up. Coming after me. No wall you won't kick down. Lie you won't tear down. Coming after me. No shadow you won't light up. Mountain you won't climb up. Coming after me. No wall you won't kick down, lie you won't tear down, coming after me. No shadow you won't light up, mountain you won't climb up, coming after me. No wall you won't kick down, lie you won't tear down, coming after me. No shadow you won't light up, mountain you won't climb up, coming after me. No wall you won't kick down, lie you won't tear down, coming after me. Oh, the overwhelming, never-ending, endless love of God. Oh, it chases me down, fight till I found is a 99. I don't deserve it, I don't deserve it. Till you give yourself away. Oh, the overwhelming, never-ending, reckless love of God. Just for me.